Everybody, it's really, really nice to be here today. This is I Can't Do Art Live number 4 now, and some of you have been watching week on week and some of you are new, but I'd really like to welcome you all and tell you how much I'd love it. I would so love it if we were all in the room together, because it would be so much fun. And yeah, I would even share my glass of my wine with you. But we're not, because we have to deal with lockdown, and this is a really good way of doing it. It's relaxing, it's ever so slightly educational, dare I use that word, in as much as you're learning a new skill, but it's definitely learning by play, so you almost don't really know that you're learning. So it's really nice to see everybody, and thank you for coming along. So today, as I just said, if people who've just tuned in could go and find themselves something to draw around, be it a pack of cards, I've got these just to give you ideas, you don't need all of these, a box of paracetamol, I've got an Oxo cube box, and I've got a box of matches. What I'm going to be doing, and you don't have to copy me, you can do your own thing, but what I'm going to be doing is going to be fine with the larger shape to draw around. But if you want to do some lettering, which is this week's subject, if you want to do some lettering that makes a longer word, then I suggest you get something smaller like this. Failing that, the other obvious option is to use a ruler. Now, the reason that I haven't just said let's get a ruler is because, of course, you'll have to excuse my dog. I think she can literally smell a rat under the floor. I don't know if my husband could perhaps find her something else to do. It's a bit annoying, her sniffing away. Anyway, a ruler is the obvious thing to use when you're trying to do lettering. But for some people, having to do measuring and all that kind of thing is kind of the opposite of fun. So I am, hence my idea of using something to draw around, because it takes that slight stress out of it, of thinking, oh, how many centimetres and all that sort of thing. But if you want to use a ruler, okay? I shall probably do a bit of both, but it would be good to have a ruler anyway, because what we can do is use the width of the ruler, which is really quite helpful. So we're not going to have to measure necessarily, but we can use the width of the ruler. So hopefully you're all set up now and sitting comfortably, which is an important part of it. Nice and relaxed, whether you've got a book on your lap or you're doing at the table or whatever, as long as you're relaxed. The most important thing that it's you recognise that this is your time, so being comfortable and relaxed is really important. So this week on the page I put up some pictures of lettering, and it's something that a few people have talked to me about, and it's also something that I've been really aware of as I've been going on my daily walk. There's been lots of posters in windows thanking the NHS, thanking posters on bins, thanking the bin men and all that sort of thing. And I really realised that for a lot of people, lettering is actually quite difficult. So I thought I'll do a really simple, and when I say simple I don't mean stupid, I mean just making it easy so that you can enjoy it and it not be a chore. A simple run through of how to do some lettering that's effective without being stressful. Okay, so on the page I put some pictures of some lettering that you will probably recognise. Now the first one is this guy. He is a very famous graphic designer called Milton Glaser, and he invented this, which I don't know, back in the 1970s, I think, came about a really, really powerful bit of lettering, which he encompasses the love heart rather than the word love. But the whole image has become a really powerful message, not just in New York, it's used now all over the world. Interestingly, he never earned a penny for that, except the prestige of having done it. But these are some of his other works. He's done the lettering and the logo for DC Comics. He did this Bob Dylan poster back in the 60s, which became really iconic. And I want you to have a good look at the lettering that says Dylan, because it's quite unusual. It's kind of striking, but minimalistic. And then this wonderful one of Barack Obama with the word hope underneath. And also on the page, I put this, which is, just a mixture of all kinds of interesting lettering that has been used over the years to make statements, and which have become really well known in their own right. You almost don't have to read this one. As soon as you see that shape and those lines, you know that it's Star Wars. Anyone from born in the 70s or earlier, dare I say it, will remember Space 1999. This is from a Cream album. This is a Russian poster. Russia seemed to really kind of take a real lead in, propaganda posters, but they did set quite a precedent back in the day. We all know this one and this one. Now, one of the reasons that I chose these particularly are that anybody that was watching last week and joined in last week, where we talked about the vanishing point, and you can see these two particularly have used the vanishing point to give the letters a sort of dynamic 3D look about them. And I just thought that was really interesting and something that those who feel comfortable doing this might want to incorporate into their wording today. So I also wanted to show you this, which is to show you that lettering isn't just used for practical purposes, for posters and advertising and record labels and all those sort of things, but it is used in art. And this is an alphabet done by my absolute favourite pop artist, a guy called Jasper Johns, and I love this. I would so have it on my wall. But if you look at the lettering, it's very uniform, it's very straightforward, it's not a fancy font, it's the sort of lettering that you might see anywhere, but he's made it into art, and obviously one of the reasons I like it is there's a strong blue and orange colour palette going on there, but also I just find it really exciting, and there's something about the intonation of, you know, what you could do with those letters about it. I also put on the page, just to show you that lettering can be very diverse and can be used in all sorts of ways. I put some of the lettering that I've done in some of my artwork, particularly for commissions for people. So you may have seen this, where you can see these are my own sort of little cartoon characters that I use for all sorts of things. They're very simple, but they really help me kind of express moods and emotions in a very sort of simple, direct way. But on some of these, I've used them to do children's names as a sort of, a birth memory. It's got their date of birth on it as well. But I've used these little characters, and then down here, I've done lettering in a sort of graffiti style, which is a style I particularly like myself. So there we are. That's what we're going to do today. And I hope you are all now sitting comfortably. I know a few people have arrived since I started. So I'm just going to remind you that what you need today is a ruler, please, if you have one. If you don't worry too much. It's not the end of the world. You might need the edge of something straight, like a book or something, as I've said before. We are in lockdown. We don't all have access to, you know, all the art supplies that we'd like, perhaps. But to go along with the ruler, something square that you can draw around. And if you remember in week two, we did some good drawing around things. So I've got a pack of cards, I've got a paracetamol box, Oxo cubes and a matchbox. So if you want to quickly go and grab something, then we can actually start. Now, as you know, each week, I just wanted to say one thing before I completely started, which is that last week when we did the Vanishing Point class, I was so impressed because even though I showed you how to do it in a quite sort of simple way, and again, when I use the word simple, I don't mean stupid, I mean just taking it right down to its absolute basics and so that you have access to it and you can start to use it and play with it. I was so impressed by the pieces of work, the imagination, the creativity that came out of you, and, you know, for a first attempt at something, they were magnificent. I was truly, truly impressed. So thank you for having a go at that. I know it was a little bit of a challenge, but you totally rose to the challenge. So thank you. So we're all ready now. We're all feeling nice and relaxed. We're gonna start by doing a little bit of doodling as we always do, just to warm our pens up and to get our mind remembering that putting a pen or a pencil on a piece of paper is not as scary as we think, because many of us do it day in, day out when we're waiting on the phone to get through to the bank or the solicitor or whichever queue we're in today, probably gov.uk for most people at the moment. So we're going to do some little doodles just to get us in the mood. I'm going to do some that wine might have affected my fingers today. My wiggly lines aren't very uniform. That's another good reason to doodle. It kind of, you know, if you're feeling a little bit stiff around the joints, it's a good way to just loosen things up a little bit while sending those very important messages to your brain that we're going to be doing something a little bit creative with a pencil, which is great. So if you just want to doodle just for a few minutes, well, not even a few minutes actually, because I'm going to speed you through doodling this week because we've got something we really want to do. So you've done a little bit of doodling. Now, if you've got your ruler, or let's start with the boxes, shall we? I'm going to choose a paracetamol box. Now, we're just going to have a little practice at drawing around them because it's not always that easy, and it is a good thing to practice. Now, once again, I say to everybody, start with a pencil. I do it with a pen so that you can all see what I'm doing. See, I've just slipped there straight away. Good job, I'm practicing. But if you do it with a pencil and you make a mistake, hopefully you've got a rubber to hand. I have, but it's not going to help me because I do it with a pen so that you can all check out what I'm doing, even my mistakes. So I'm just going to practice that a couple of times till I feel that I've quite got. It's the corners that are the difficult bits, isn't it? But going around a corner, because I'm doing it in pen, I might even ignore the corners, because I don't really need them at the moment. What I just need is to be able to draw that shape. Okay, third time I kind of got it just right, and I hope that you're finding that with just a little bit of practice. Let me try around my Oxo cube box. This is our rough paper, so it doesn't matter if we go over and over things. Yeah, that's all right, that's working okay. That's fine. So what, if you haven't already guessed, these are going to be our guides for our lettering. And that will help us keep them uniform. So you've had a nice practice now. So let's get a clean sheet of paper. Keep your doodling paper there, because when you start to do something new, it's often a good idea to just go get your practice paper back out and think, I'm just going to have a practice of this before I go on to the real thing. I just want to say hello to Anne from Martock. I don't know where Martock is, so it can't be too local, though I have to confess that my knowledge of all the Devon villages and hamlets is not as good as it should be, considering I've been here for well over 20 years now. So, anyway, I digress. Let me just get the fresh piece of paper, I'll put that one over there so you can see. Now, what we're going to do, you are going to do one piece of work, okay? I'm going to do one piece of work, but while you're doing yours, if you need some help and advice, you can tell me what letters that you are having a bit of trouble with by sending a message on the live. My husband can tell me, and we can do that letter, okay? But obviously I can't do the entire alphabet. Unfortunately, it would take quite a while. So here's something I prepared earlier. This week I had a bit of a play, and these are the letters that I have been seeing all around in the last few weeks, and rightly so. So here we are. I did this. And obviously it's my little tribute to our NHS. And I haven't decorated it any further. I may well put a rainbow on it or something like that. But these are the letters I'm going to do today. A, because these are the letters that most people are trying to do, but also there's one other reason. S is by far the hardest letter to draw yourself accurately. So I'm going to do the S because that is the one of all the letters that most people, including myself, have a bit of a problem with. This is another one that I did this week, which is just a little bit more fun, but it's the same thing. As you can see on this, I used a vanishing point, by the way. The vanishing point was up here, so all these lines went to the vanishing point. And people who haven't seen last week's, don't worry about that, okay? But I'm just saying this for the sake of people who've seen last week. So all these lines went up to the vanishing point, and then I decided I was going to cut them off across. I rubbed all the guidelines out that were above that line, but I managed to get this nice 3D sort of effect here. And this is another one I did just for play. And if you can't read it, it says pandemic. I think I was having a little bit of a tough day with the whole lockdown virus thing when I did that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how to do NHS, but you can use any words you want, okay? You might want to do some lettering. You might be in a band, might want to do some lettering for a logo for your band. You might be wanting to do a personalised birthday card for somebody and put their name on it. You might want to just write happy birthday. That's quite a big sentence, but we can work on that. But what I'm going to do is show you the simple principles of writing letters. Now, what you will have noticed from this is that all the letters I'm using are block capital letters. And the reason for that is because all block capital letters can fit into the same uniform size. If you start trying to do upper and lowercase letters, then it becomes very quickly very complicated. Now, I had a look this week on YouTube actually to see if there was anything, because this is a sort of a technique that I've developed myself. So I had a look on YouTube to see if there was anything that just showed you a really simple, sort of accessible way into doing some lettering that you would feel pleased with. And I couldn't find anything. I found loads of things about calligraphy and typefaces and that sort of thing, but I couldn't find anything that was just, look, here's the basics, here's how to do some lettering that you're going to feel happy with. So that's why I'm doing this. So this is my technique. First of all, you decide how long your word is. Now in this case, I've just got three letters. That makes it really simple because they're going to be easy to fit on the page. If I had five letters, I'd have to, so I can use my biggest rectangle because that is easily going to fit on the page. If I was doing a five or a six letter word, I'd have to go with my Oxycube box, because to be able to fit that on the page, and you do need to measure it up, I could just about get six on there, but it would be a bit of a squeeze. I'd probably be inclined to go even smaller and go for that. Okay, now, the first important rule about doing any lettering is to write out your word in capitals on your rough piece of paper. So I am going to show you, write out, oh dear, I've got dead pen again. Let me try this one. Here we go. N-H-S. So, it's a three-letter word. What I need to do next, you might want to write peace. You might want to write love. So I'm just giving you some examples here. So, work out how many letters your word is for a start. Mine is three, that NHS is three letters, peace is five letters, love is four letters. Find your middle letter. That is obvious on these three letter words. Here is my middle letter. On love, it's not so obvious, it's a four letter word. But what that means is the middle position runs between the two letters O and V. So this is the first principle. Find the middle point of your letters, okay? That way, you won't end up, I'm sure you've all seen that amazing picture where someone has painted think ahead and they've run out of space and the D is hanging off the bottom. This is how we stop that happening, okay? This is how we make sure that our lettering sits nicely in the middle of what we're wanting to do, okay? If you want to do your lettering to one side, that makes it really much easier. You literally just start with the first letter and keep going until you've finished. But if you want to centre your lettering, which most people do when they're doing posters and that sort of thing, it probably, you know, some marketing guy will tell you, it has by far the greatest impact if it's in the middle. Then we find out our middle place letter. So for what I'm going to do, H is my middle letter. The next thing I do, and you can decide how you do this, but I'm going to put my glasses on, not that I need them for this, but just so I can see. The next thing I do, because I'm a little bit of a cheat, is I just fold my paper in half, and without scoring a thick line down it, I just pinch the end of it so that I can see where the middle position on my paper is. If you don't want to do that, if you don't want to put a pinch in your paper, then measure it, okay? Now, like I said when I started, people who are happy and comfortable using rulers, measuring stuff, and are happy to incorporate that into their art time, then do it. Absolutely do it, because that is obviously the way you're going to get the most accuracy. But what I'm doing here now is a way of doing it without having to do all the measuring and stuff, if you're not happy doing that, or if it makes it boring, or, you know, whatever. And also if you don't have a ruler. You know, not everybody has a ruler. I have about 300 of them around the house. So I always lose them and then replace them, and you know how it is. So if I were to measure that with my ruler, I would hopefully find that actually where I put that crease is pretty much dead centre. So that's fantastic. Now, the next thing I'm going to do, because I want, in this case, I want my lettering to sit in a nice straight line. I could do the whole measuring up a few centimetres and that sort of thing, but to make my own life a lot easier, I am just going to put my ruler right at the bottom of the page and draw a guideline, which you will be doing in pencil, because then you can rub it out, but I'm doing it in pen so you can see. I'm going to draw a guideline at the bottom. Easy peasy. There we are. So now all my letters are going to sit on that line. I have identified the middle of my page. I might just put a little mark there. You might want to do this. You might even just want to draw a line up the centre so you know where you are. Now, if you want to be really accurate, you can measure your box, pack of cards, whatever you're using. This is just over 6 centimetres, so halfway is just over 3 centimetres. If you don't want to do the measuring, once again, I can't emphasise this enough, use your eye. Trust your eye. Trust what you see. Okay, so I am going to put my box so that it's sitting, if you can see that, it's sitting exactly, let me just turn this around, it's sitting with its base exactly on the line. I don't know if I can see it from upside down. There we are. and I'm using my eye to find the center point, and then I am going to draw around it, and that gives me my first guide for my first letter. Okay? Now, for the other letters, the only decision I have to make now is what sort of space I want between them. Again, you can do this with your ruler if you want to, half a centimetre space or whatever. You can do it with your eye. If you want, you can have them touching and just have them right straight up against each other. If you're feeling, you know, that you want to kind of make the space visual, you can just slightly overlap it, draw around it. If I just do that side like that, then you'll see what I mean. So draw down it, draw the other side. I haven't done this very well because I haven't sat it properly on the line. But that then becomes your space. But then you have to replicate that same distance the other side. So my advice to you, that is one way of doing it, okay? And I like to give people options because people's minds work in very different ways, and we know that from education. Some people are visual learners, some people are audio learners, some people, you know, learn by rote. You know, we all have very, very different ways of learning and very, very different ways of problem solving. So I like to give you as many options as I can. So I'm just going to quickly continue this. Let me just do my halfway point, do my ruler line, and do my middle letter again. And hopefully, you are probably ahead of me now. Nicola says she's just done that. I think she was ahead of me. She could see what was coming up. Well done, Nicola. That's great minds thinking alike, or what's the other one they say? Fools never differ. Either way, we're on the same page, which is great. So I've done my first letter. What I'm going to do, again, to make it really easy for people, I am going to use a measure that I can rely on that is going to be uniform. So for this space, I'm just going to use my finger, my little finger. I'm going to do a mark, and that's where I'm going to put my next letter. And you can do it like that, again, if you find using rulers and doing all that kind of stuff a bit boring, then don't do it, because we must not add stress. So I'm going to do that again. I'm going to be covered in pen again by the end of today, which is the usual, and I'm going to draw around this one more time. So now I have my three guides for my three letters, and hopefully you can see from that that they are well spaced apart, equally spaced apart, should I say, and they are all a uniform size. Now, before we go on to do our lettering, there are a million and one types of lettering out there. You only have to go onto your Word document or whatever, and you will see so many fonts, typefaces, whatever you want to get. It will make your head spin. Okay, so what we're going to do today, we're going to do something really quite simple and straightforward, but I'm also going to show you just a few of the things that you could do if you want to have something that isn't just sort of very regular block letters. So just looking back again at Milton Glaser's work, if you have a look, the word hope he's done here is, you know, quite a uniform, very easy to read lettering. The letters he's used for I Love New York are what we call serifed, which means they have these little bits that stick out on the end. And letters that don't have those little bits are called sans serif. So basically, if they have twiddly bits, it will say Helvetica serif, or if they don't have them, it will say Helvetica sans serif, and that's the only difference, the twiddly bits or not. And you can easily add those to your lettering if you want to. Okay, but I'm just going to show you how to do basic uniform lettering. So, once again, to avoid doing the measuring, I could do that, but on the first letter I'm going to do, which is my central letter, which is the H, I'm going to use my finger. But before I do that, what we need to identify next is the midpoint. Now, capital letters. This is one of the reasons why doing capital letters is ideal, because they do follow a similar sizing pattern all the way through. And as you can see on this word lettering, the line that runs through the center catches, well, the G is very slightly lower, but we're not going to do that. This is a particular typeface and they've decided for some random reason to make the line on the G lower. But we are going to make a central line that all our letters can sit on. Now again, you can measure to do this. If I look at that, it's just 9.5 centimetres, so I know it's 4.25 centimetres down. You can do it by eye, which is what I'm going to do. But you also need to remember that there's no right or wrong about this. There are plenty of typefaces out there that do not have that central line dead centre. Some have them up high. If you've ever seen sort of typefaces from the 1920s, it's very popular to have thin letters with very high top halves. So let's not worry about that. As long as the line runs through them all at the same level, kind of in the middle, that's fine. Okay, so I'm going to put a guideline in here, and that will help me get my lettering uniform. Okay, and as I can see from my guideline, it's actually not very straight, but it is at least a straight line. Now, what I'm going to do with the H, I'm going to use my fingers again, because I don't want to spend for ages measuring it up. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to make a mark at the bottom. I'm going to make a mark at the top for the two uprights. And quite simply, to do any letter that has an upright, that is all you need to do. Now remember, we're doing this in pencil, okay? And I'm going to do the same at the bottom. Use my finger as a guide. You can use your rulers and they will be for sure a bit neater than mine, but for the sake of making it as straightforward for everyone as I possibly can, we now have our two uprights. Now, I'm using a ruler for this. Often when I do lettering, I actually do it freehand, and so I might make my points and then I will do the lettering by hand. That's fine. You can do that if you'd rather have a go, because it is a good skill to practice. But if it's something that makes you feel a bit anxious, then stick with the ruler. You don't have to use a ruler. You can if you want. Now, to get the horizontal of the H, I'm going to put my finger in the middle. If you've been using a ruler, you will know, and measuring, you will know exactly where to put your mark. So I'm going to use that mark as my guideline and take it across like that. So now I have done my H, and I'm fairly happy with that. It could be a little bit straighter at this end. I think maybe I squashed my finger down a bit too far. I mean, you could use other things. You could use a pen and mark it up using a pen. If you want to do really big ones, you could use the width of the ruler. I'm just trying to make it as simple for you as possible. So, that's the H done. We're going to do the same. An N, if you think about the letter N, we've done it on our paper, it's the same, it has two uprights. So once again, I'm going to do my mark it up using my finger, just to make it as easy as possible, and do my uprights like that. Now, the most obvious thing to do to join these two up would be to do a line from there to there, from that corner to the inside corner, and then from the top corner there down to there. And that does work, but if you want to use your finger again and make marks, you can do. But for to do an end like that, sorry Lee, could you please help me out here with that again? Thank you. Then use your finger because it will make it a lot easier. But you can measure it if you want. Now, S, this is the big difficult one. Before I go on to the S though, if you're doing, I hope that now you've got the principle. The one caveat that I would say about lettering is, and I'm just going to draw another box here so that I can illustrate this for you. And that is that we have some letters which are a little bit awkward in that they go to a central point. So if I mark this up, I'm just going to show you letters like the letter A, letter Y, any letters that require you to go to a central point. Now, for the sake of this, for the sake of keeping it as straightforward as possible, my advice to you is not to do a letter A that goes to the center like that. My advice is to use the same principle and do it in a block style, like this. So you go up to the top, you do the two upright lines, just like that. You do the central cross line and the top line, just like that. And you make a letter A, like that. Now in a minute, I'm going to show you how to turn block letters into something a little bit softer. If you want to do a letter A, I'm just trying to think, what other letters go to a point like that? I can't think if there are any. But if you want to try that, then obviously you have to find your middle point and kind of work down that way. But this is a much more straightforward, and what it also does, when you've done all your lettering, it makes it look like they are actually a proper typeface. And so they all look very, you know, very similar. So, you know, going back to our NHS. Now, S. S is a bit of a devil of a letter when you're trying to do it block because it curves so much. So what the short line, there's long lines at the bottom and then long line, you know, it's a real nuisance letter to draw. So this is how I go about it. And same thing, because S has got uprights, it's got an upright at the bottom. If you think about the shape of an S, we have an upright here and we have an upright here. So I'm going to draw that bit in. We have at the top bit, we have the upright there and the upright there. So I'm going to draw those two in. And if you remember, we're doing this in pencil, so the bits that we don't want, when we come to fine tune it, which is what we're going to do, we can rub out. Then it has three horizontal lines. One runs through the middle like that, so I'm just going to mark that up. One sits right at the top like that, and one is down here. So I'm going to draw those three lines in now, and then we have got our basic letter S. And you'll see that because my central line was a little bit high, the top of my S is a little bit higher than it would be, but they all the central lines run along one central place. Okay, so now I've got my basic letters ready, but they do look a little bit square, a little bit, you know, a little bit, they're not very interesting. So this is what I'm going to do. To make them a little bit more interesting, you can soften up the edges. Now, if I do this in a different colour, you might be able to see better what I'm doing. So, when we get to, I'm going to decide at the top of my letters whether I'm going to round them off a bit or whether I'm going to give them angles like the DC has got here. Okay. And I'm going to, on this one, I'm going to round them off. So I've got my basic letter, and all I'm going to do is just round the corners off a little bit, just to make them a little bit softer. And I'm going to do the same, I hope you can see that, on the S here, in all the places where it bends around, I'm just going to give it a little bit of a curve to make it just look a little bit, I think a little bit more professional really. Right, Roxanne, I'll be with you in just 1 second and I will show you what I mean about the A. There we go, so there we are, I've rounded off my letters just a little bit to give them a slightly softer feel and to make them look a little bit more uniform. Now I know it's difficult for you to see that because of all the guidelines and all that sort of thing, but hopefully you have the idea of what I've done there. Now Roxanne has asked if I can finish off the A. So I've done the A a bit like the letter H. I'm going to do it upside down so you can see clearly, Roxanne. Okay, so I've basically done it like a letter H, but I've added the top line. So it's going to be an A that's a bit more like this. Okay? And all I'm going to do, again, with this one, is just round off the corners, just to soften it up a bit. And give it, you know, a little bit more of a uniform look with the other letters. What you could do, and I'll do this in another colour, hopefully you can see this, I could do angled corners. I could do it like that. It's quite a big angle actually. But this is how you can turn your basic lettering into something a little bit more, dare I say, artistic or creative or whatever. You can add little effects to it like that. Now, if you really want to do there's some of the letters that are a little bit difficult actually, and so I need to sort of address those. And those are things like M's and W's. They are really awkward. But if we stick with our guidelines, the guidelines will kind of dictate the shape that we make. So if I very quickly draw another box here. God, you know what happens? The lesson starts and I'm all organised, and within, you know, 5-10 minutes sometimes, it's all over the place. So here's my box, here's my guide box. I'm going to show you how to do an M. Okay, now, what's my ruler gone? There it is. So I've got my middle line. And we have a letter M has two uprights, so I'm going to use my finger again to get my upright lines. So this is going to be a very square letter M. Now I know sometimes capital M's are like that, so they flare out at the bottom, and a capital W the same. But this is going to be this sort of M. Okay, so it's going to be very square, and that's fine, because because it will be effective, because it will work in favour with the other letters. Now, to find the point at which I bring the dip in the M down to, I'm going to put my finger on here, make that mark again, and you can see that is where the dip is going to come down to. Now, it's the most simple way to do the V in the middle of the letter M is just to follow from the bottom line where you would have, if you were doing letter H or whatever, where you'd have the lower line or the letter S. Put your pen where that is and just take it up to the corner. From the upper line, put your pen where that is and take it up to the inside part of your upright. So there you can see we've got a letter M. If you want to do it slightly differently, you could put a line here and follow the letters up to there. Those are two options, okay? So you can make it pointy or you can bring it down to a flat edge, but it still follows the same principle of following the same central guideline that you use on all your other letters. And I'm just going to demonstrate one more, and that is the letter O. And if you haven't already guessed, our letter O with this is also going to be to look like the same typeface as all the other letters. So guideline, 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 guideline. I'm just going to draw that up, draw that up, draw that across, draw that across, and because it's an O, I'm going to turn the corners in so that it looks, it gives it the round shape that you would expect to see from the letter O. Hilary's asked for an I. Now I'm really glad you've asked me about this, Hilary, because the I in a lot of poster letters could be awkward. So, and the reason that is, if you look at the word in here, Milton, the I, even though it's a capital, it has no crossbars on it. It has no horizontals. And that kind of suggests that if you're using this principle of drawing something, that you're going, that the I is going to sit either very emptily in the middle of the space between the other letters. What I would do, what I would advise you as you're starting out on your journey into lettering, is not to do an I like that, is to do an I that has a crossbar. That way, it comes out the same size, and this, of course, that goes right down the middle. Again, you might want to use your eye, you might want to use a ruler, whatever. But if you want to do, use this technique of having all your letters nice and uniform, then this is by far the simplest way to do the letter I. Again, I am rushing this, so please forgive the fact that my letters are a little bit wibbly-wobbly. If I had a bit more time and I wasn't rushing through this, even if just a few more seconds would probably help me kind of centre it a little bit better, etc. But yes, so I would think about doing my eye like that. That way, it is the same size as all the other letters. Okay, if you really want to try and do a letter I that is just a single stroke, a single upright stroke, then you need to think about that when you go right back to the beginning and you're doing, you're working out your spacing. So if we were to say that a letter I, just a single upright I, is, you'd have to sort of work out what percentage of your box it is, so maybe it's a third of the size of it, and you'd have to do a bit of maths to enable yourself to fit it in without having a big gap between it and the other letters. So you'd have to accommodate it. So my advice, because it's very important to me to make this as simple and straightforward and accessible as everybody. And the truth is that when you do this, when you do it a few times and you practice it, you will start to use your own amazing problem-solving skills and start to think of other ideas and other ways to do it. And you might come across, you might think, I'm actually going to do an eye that way instead of the other way. So, but for right now, make life easy for yourself and do an eye using the horizontal lines. Now, I know it's 2:15 now, but I just wanted to just show you a couple of other little things, if you don't mind. And that was, if you see that I've made this one 3D, so we've got my lettering, and the very simple way, the very, very simple way to do that. Now, where is my, that's not my images, that's my images on pages. So, the very simple way, if you want to make your letters look a little bit three-dimensional, for anybody who wasn't watching last week, do this one, you find the point in the middle of the page, which we've already done, if you remember here. So I'm going to take that point up here, I'm going to just put a point on the paper, okay? And in order to make this three-dimensional, and again use pencil to do this, because you can always go over it afterwards with pen, you can colour it in, you can do patterns on it as we've done in previous weeks, you can turn it into a work of its art in its own right. So all I would do to make it look three-dimensional in that way is take all the corner lines from my letters up to that vanishing point that I've drawn at the top. Okay, so all of the letters, and I won't do all of them because we might be here all night and we need to be finished in time to give our round of applause, but including the lower ones. But obviously when you're doing the lines from the bottom of the letters, don't let them run through, because they would obviously, the letters, they would be hidden by the letters in front of them. So even that inner curve will go up like that, this one will go up like that, and I hope you can see all the corner points of the letters will go off to the vanishing point. And then you can have the three-dimensionalness of it go all the way up to the vanishing point, or you can do what I did, decide, right, I'm going to cut it off just here. And you've done all of them, cut it off just here and rub that out, and then you have your three-dimensional letters. Your vanishing point doesn't have to be in the centre. If you want it to be off to one side so that your letters appear to be, you know, coming from one angle, you can put your vanishing point up here and have all the lines going up to there, and that will also give you, I don't know if there's an example of that on here. No, there isn't, sadly. There's an example of that on here either. No. When it comes to, when you've got your basic letter, you've rubbed out all the lines that you don't need, you're left with your letters, when it comes to it, enjoy playing with them. Enjoy, you know, adding to the design. If you have a look at this, I love what this one's done, where it's stretched the letters out to the bottom, it's done the vanishing point lines all in different colours, for example. And what's Milton done? Where's Milton's piece of paper? Here it is. So on this one, he's put he's left a sort of guideline around the outside of it, and these ones, as you can see, also they're sort of done in stripes, and you can have lots of fun just really kind of almost designing your own typeface with how you choose to complete the lettering. One of my favourite ways to do it is to use my patterns, as I've done on that one, Mary, or on this one. If you want to do one with serifs, you can literally just take, flare the, and you get a letter with serifs. There are so many other things you can do with lettering that are lots and lots of fun, but I think we're going to have to stop there, because we're running out of time, and it's nearly 8 o'clock when we have to go, and we don't have to, but we do have to. It's absolutely right that we do go and say, give our thanks to the NHS and all the other key workers who are keeping us going at this really difficult time. So thank you for bearing with me on that. I've realised that it's a little bit, you know, it's a little bit technical, but I think once you've had a play with it and had a go at it, I think you'll be quite pleasantly surprised. Please let me see your work. You know I love to see what you do. Keep your expectations for yourself realistic, you know, just enjoy that you found a new way to do something, and I really look forward to seeing what you've done. Thank you very much for joining me today, and have a really good week, okay? And take care of yourselves. I'll see you next week. Bye.